Good morning and welcome to the Berks County Board of Commissioners meeting for November the 30th. We'll begin with a moment of silence followed by a pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We're going to begin with a special presentation by Mike Malinowski from EH&D. He's the vice president and manager of EH&D Insurance in Wyomissing. It says bank, but I think it's branch manager. I was going to say, whoa, EH&D going into the banking business.
Have you disclosed this on your ethics form?
No, we're not, please.
So this is to discuss the tax collector bonding program. Yes. But just before you do that, at CCAP's fall conference, my wife and I attended the P Corp 30th anniversary.
Oh, okay.
And I know you actually are the individual that introduced us to P Corp. How many years ago?
Well, we originally were with their Cobalt program.
Right.
But they opened up the P Corp program to us. So I bet you 6-7 years we've been with CCAP.
And that's been so good for us. In many cases, they have coverages that are just not available elsewhere, but also looking at the money they return back to each of the members each year. But thank you for the work you've done in the P-Corp area. And P-Corp is 30 years old this year.
Get out. They've been a very good partner for the County of Berks, I know, and the Pelican program
for the nursing home.
That's that in our marketplace. There's not a lot of standard insurance companies beating the door down to write government entities that have prisons and nursing homes and things of that nature. So CCAP really has stepped up. And that would lead right into this, commissioners. And thank you. I'll be very quick and couple of minutes is CCAP. The other program that we administer on behalf of the county and the county commissioners is the tax collector bonding program, which starts, as you all know, there was an election in November where all the tax collectors were up for re-election or new tax collectors were elected. And CCAP offers a four-year prepaid bonding program, which 52 counties now participate in, which provides a significant discount to the taxpayers, quite honestly, that have to pay for this surety premium that they're required to by law. So EH&D, on behalf of the county, starts this process in August, notifying the school districts. We have to touch everybody, the school districts, the county, and the municipalities, let them know to budget this premium, let them know there's going to be applications coming out. And there's a lot of work that goes behind the scenes for that. And I really have to give a shout out to Dennis and his team, who always is very helpful for us, because it's an extremely laborious process in order to get and notify all these people. But it does provide a significant discount. And I think the commissioners, I just want you to be aware, because you probably, it doesn't seem like a lot, but you're probably saving $30,000 to $50,000 for the taxpayers because of this program based on the standard market.
To most people in our county, that's a lot of money.
That's a lot.
That includes me.
And it's been great. And we have not had anyone opt out of it, which is good, because I think it would be tough for them to secure the bond elsewhere. But we get a lot of questions. So what I'm here to do today is just ask a little help from the county. 4 years ago, you allowed us to put a frequently asked questions document and the application out on the website, your website. The tax collectors just tend to go to your website. So putting it out on EH&D's website is not going to be very helpful. So what we'd like to do is put out a blank application and some questions about what they need to do and how they can handle it. And we think it will help, because we're getting a lot of the same questions. And I don't know if you're familiar, not to bore you with some of the law, but Act 164 in 2014 was passed regarding deputies. The DCED requires every tax collector now to have a deputy. And they always have questions about bonding. Deputies are not covered under this bond, P per se. The tax collector who's elected is the one who's responsible for their deputy. The deputy can secure bonding, but that has to be paid for differently. It's not part of this program. So since that act was passed in 2014, we're getting a lot of questions about that. And we think it would help if we just put something out there and kind of, you know, 10 questions that could be answered and help Linda not get questions, EH&D. And we have an actual email address we set up called berkstc@ehnd-ins.com that the tax collectors have been communicating with us. So I could go into a whole lot of detail, but I would just ask, and I'm not sure if Ron or
we'll someone support, could send me that. I just checked. We support the request. If you would work with Ron, Ron would work with IS to get that up right away.
Okay. That's great. So, Ron, I'll give you a call. Astra's in Disney, so kind of without my right-hand man right now, right-hand woman, to help get through this process. But if any tax collectors are watching or listening, we just let them know next week we'll have something out there. They can call our office because, you know, you can't take office unless you have a bond. And hopefully, fingers crossed, everyone qualifies and receives the bond. Sometimes that can create some issues also, which we always have every election, but we try to work through that process. So we appreciate your support. If anyone has any questions or comes to you as commissioners, feel free to send them our way. We have the information. Give Dennis's team a break. We'll be happy to answer any of the questions.
So you want this on the homepage and the election services page?
Election?
Is that the way they
treasure?
Treasurer.
Debbie's
the
one that sends the results out.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's where they go for most of their information. Yeah.
Yeah, they come directly to us, yeah. So we can help them out.
And then we can just forward that on. But we'll start working on the questions and everything to have it out there. But thank you. And thank you for, you know, supporting the program. It does really, especially the school districts who pay the largest portion of it because they tax us the most, it provides them the greatest discount for having this program. So any questions?
Sounds good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good job.
Are there any additions or corrections for the November 16th commissioner meeting minutes? Seeing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. Is there any public comment on specific agenda items? Seeing none, we'll move into the agenda under item one, authorizing budget department. We have three items. Item A, adopt a resolution authorizing 2017 budget transfers in the amount of $4,035,093 and 2017 appropriations in the amount of $4,043,002 per listing date of November 27th of 17. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the P-Corp application and the 2018-2019 P-Corp renewal payment option for June 1, 2018 renewals. Item C, adopt a resolution authorizing our chief financial officer to bind public officials' crime policy coverage effective January 1 of 2018. Under human resources, we have one item, authorize the promotion of Valerie Genslinger from Conference Officer 3 to Fiscal and Docketing Manager in Domestic Relations. One item under facilities, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the letter of authorization to Verizon Pennsylvania LLC and Verizon Reading Pennsylvania consenting to the installation, operation, and maintenance by Verizon of cable and other equipment at the Berks County Agricultural Center in Bern Township to provide communication services to tenants and other occupants at the center. One item listed under Magisterial District Court, adopt a resolution authorizing execution of the addendum to lease agreement between Kots, how do you say that? What's that? Katsakis Family Limited Partnership, Wernersville, Pennsylvania, and the County of Berks for lease of office space located at Westgate Shops in Wernersville. This is used by Magisterial District Court Ann Young, and this is a one-year term beginning May 1st of 18 and a monthly rent of $4,780.37. Some appointments listed under Commissioner Barnhart. Item A, adopt a resolution authorizing reappointment of Mary Edwards, Kutztown, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Public Libraries for a three-year term expiring December 31st of 2020. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Deborah L. Noel, Morgantown, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Public Libraries for a three-year term expiring December 31st of 2020. Dr. Noel is replacing Judy Schwambach, who's stepping down. Several appointments listed under Commissioner Scott. Item A, adopt a resolution authorizing the reappointment of Linda Groff, Reading, PA, to the Berks County Office of Aging Advisory Council for a two-year term expiring December 31st of 2019. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the reappointment of Dr. Colin Good, West Reading, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Office of Aging Advisory Council for a two-year term expiring December 31st of 2019. Item C, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Sandy Graffius, Reading, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Office of Aging Advisory Council for a two-year term expiring December 31st, 2019. Ms. Graffius is replacing Karen Fator, who is stepping down. Do you have a comment,
Mr. Chairman,
Commissioner Scott?
I'd like to appoint qualified individuals to serve on all my advisory board appointments, and who better to deal with aging issues than our octogenarian, or whatever, I'm not sure what your age is now, Sandy, and I'm not inquiring, but I'm sure you'll do an excellent job. You're certainly qualified to deal with those aging issues.
I do appreciate the appointment.
Okay. My pleasure.
I have plenty to say.
Well, based on the description he gave, I thought he was going to appoint himself.
But. I'm not there yet.
Well, many years of service. It's a two-year term, right?
Oh, my goodness. Okay. I have a good 20 years.
There you go.
Item D, adopt a resolution authorizing the reappointment of Jonathan Encarnacion, Reading, PA, to the Berks County Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities Advisory Board for a three-year term expiring December 31st of 2020. And then one appointment under me. Item A, adopt a resolution authorizing the reappointment of Veronica S. Seitzinger, Reading, PA, to the Berks County Children and Youth Services Advisory Board for a three-year term expiring December 31st of 2020. There's one item listed under Commissioners, adopt a resolution authorizing the Chief Clerk to advertise enactment of proposed county ordinance authorizing execution of an intergovernmental agreement establishing a PREA hotline between the County of Berks and the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania Department of Corrections that establishes a mechanism for individuals to report allegations of sexual abuse occurring at county correctional facilities. This new IGA replaces the intergovernmental agreement previously authorized by the county in ordinance number 04-2014 and provides more efficient and reliable service, and the responsibility for receiving such calls will be transferred to the Bureau of Community Corrections Management Operations Center. Item two, a motion authorizing execution of contract agreements and amendments as furnished by the contract coordinator is set forth on the attached listing dated November 28th of 2017. There are a total of 12 contracts. There are three with mental health and developmental disabilities. There is one with the Berksheim. There are two with the Berks County Residential Center, one with the Comptroller's Office, one with children and youth, one jointly children and youth and juvenile probation, two with Career Link, and one with the Area Agency on Aging. And then item three, a motion to ratify and confirm payments is set forth in the Comptroller's Office voucher listing. It's dated November the 28th of 17 for the week ending November 29th of 17 and the payment of electronic transfers and employee payroll that's been signed by the commissioners and is with our chief clerk.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
I second the motion.
The motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the motion is carried. With that, we'll turn to our county treasurer, Dennis Adams, with the treasurer's report.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We have an opening balance today of $147,981,811.24, a balance to clear of $3,457,255.52, leaving us with a balance today of $144,524,555.72.
Thank you. And Sandy Graffius, our county controller, with the controller's report.
Our general accounts payable was $1,422,342. We had wire transfers of $4,535,613. We had a payroll this week, $4,199,093.33, for a grand total of $10,157,049.51.
Very good. Thank you. And our Chief Financial Officer, Mr. Bob Patrizio, with the agenda for this afternoon's budget operations meeting.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Morning.
We do have a meeting today. It starts at 2 p.m. We will have our district attorney here with our HR, our acting HR director, to discuss a request for pay increases. We will also have our required annual bond compliance and swap update. Our financial advisor, Mike Vinn, will be joining me in that presentation. And then we also have a presentation by Stevens and Lee to the board. That'll be attended by Mr. Vinn as well. And then our director of aging and mental health services will be doing a presentation or discussion on performance-based senior center funding. Mm. That's the agenda.
No cash flow, Bob.
No.
You're saying there is no cash flow? Is that what you're saying?
No. No, we're good right now.
I thought you would round out the meeting with cash flow.
Yeah, we're okay right now.
I just wanted to clarify the question and the answer.
Yes. Yeah. I will not be providing a cash flow update today.
Very good. Thank you. I turn to our Chief Administrative Officer, Ron Seaman. Nothing?
Thanks, Chairman. I have nothing at this point.
Commissioner Barnhart.
Thank you. I have one item. If you haven't had enough of county government yet, at 11 a.m. we have our election board meeting where we will be identifying and accumulating write-in votes from the November 7th election, as well as breaking tie votes in some of the elections that were held on November 7th. So if you want to stay in your seats till 11 o'clock, it'll be some riveting information. Thank you.
Commissioner Scott.
Just wanted to comment that I think the last meeting we had, we discussed the proposed budget, and it entailed a 4.08% tax increase, something that the board has yet to finalize, and that remains up in the air. But we did receive a surprising amount of mail in response to that meeting and the article which ensued in the Reading Eagle. It was a front page article. 4% tax increase is the lowest of the tax increases that have been proposed since I'm in office. I'll take you down memory lane. In 1995, the year before I was elected, I took office in 96, we had a 39% tax increase. Circa 2002, we had an 18% increase. Around 2006, we had a 33% increase, one that Commissioner Linebach successfully exploited in his campaign.
Yep, it was actually five that went into effect. 2005, right?
Okay, 2005? All right, thank you. And then we had one around 7% that this board put in place in a previous term. So four is by far the smallest, but I've received a number of pieces of correspondence, and I'm always happy to receive those. They're interesting, and they reveal the extent to which the public understands state and county government. And one of the primary misunderstandings among the public with regard to county government is that they think that we have great legislative powers and can in fact change the nature of our institution. But unless we adopt a home rule charter, which has by most accounts been a disaster throughout the state of Pennsylvania. We're stuck with a third-class county code in Berks County, and we are, in essence, a creature of state legislation. And we have to operate within the parameters of that state legislation. So many of the things that taxpayers would like us to do, we are not permitted to do by law. And their ire is better directed at the state legislature than at us, though I'm not trying to deflect blame. I'm just trying to place it where it properly belongs. Here's a email we received. I won't mention the woman's name, but she says the following, and I'll try to respond to some of these things. Dear Commissioners, I want to express my dismay at the proposed 4% county tax increase. Why not put this up for a vote in the next election? How can you reduce costs? Change your employee benefits to match those of us poor taxpayers. Why do we need to pay benefits that we do not enjoy ourselves at our jobs? We consider ourselves lucky to have a job in today's employment climate and need to accept what is offered by our employers. I do not have dental vision or sick time at my job. County employees enjoy all of the above, plus personal days, 6 more holidays, and more vacation pay. I am not aware of your retirement program, but my option is a 401k plan, 3% match maximum by my company. Please come down to earth and stop hitting the taxpayers when there's a deficit. In my household, we cut down on household expenses such as cable, eating out. There is no one to pass the buck to, so we can maintain discretionary spending. I urge you to do the same. Thank you. Just a couple observations here. We cannot put the tax increase or the budget up to a binding referendum. There has to be specific authorizing legislation, enabling legislation, again, enacted by the state legislature that would permit the county to do that. So if you want that to happen, contact your state legislator. How can you reduce costs? Well, we've been talking about reducing costs. We talked about privatizing the Berks Heim, or facsimile thereof. We also spoke to the issue of privatizing the prison, something that has produced a number of protesters here who are seeking to prevent the county from even considering privatizing the prison, something which some experts speculate could save the county millions of dollars. I have yet to see any taxpayers come to the commissioners' meeting and say, please consider privatizing the prison so we don't have to have a tax increase. So all you people who send me emails, how about get in your car, come down to the commissioners' meeting, and you'll have 3 minutes of fame before the microphone, in which time you can urge us to privatize the prison and save millions of dollars and reduce the tax increase that is proposed. With regard to all these benefits, let me point out that a benefit package has value. And when you're hiring somebody and you have a rich benefit package, which by all accounts the county does have, you're able to offer a lower salary. If you don't have much in the way of benefits and an individual has to go out and buy them on his own, typically he will demand a higher salary. The bottom line here is it basically washes out. It's a very competitive labor market these days, as the new Republican administration is causing unemployment to shrink to all-time lows. So if you are opposed to this, you ought to also consider the union issue. We have 6 unions in the county. Many of the benefits, 7?
Actually, 8.
Shame on me for not realizing 8. 8 union.
Keeps growing.
Wow. Okay. And rising, perhaps. Who knows? 8 unions, and the benefit packages are negotiated in those contracts. Some of them are very expensive benefits. I think the Teamsters health plan is the most expensive benefit package the county offers. I haven't seen anyone come to the microphone here yet decrying the lavish and expensive benefits that Teamsters receive, but they're welcome to do so at future meetings. So if you're against the county benefits, you're probably against the union negotiated contracts and would like to see them negotiated to a lower benefit level. And that goes back to the issue, how can you reduce your costs? Well, the county is involved in negotiations almost all the time with its various unions seeking to get better, more productive working conditions and to make the benefits offered by the county through those contracts more in sync with what is available in the private sector. So that takes care of that. I do appreciate the correspondence, though, and I hope that I've begun to respond to some of the inquiries. Also, on the issue of the prison, we've had a number of people who've come here, prison employees or their relatives, who have told us that the prison operates very well and it would operate worse, and the prisoners in particular would be treated worse under a private operator, something I'm not certain of, but I know that there have been abuses in both the governmental and the private sector area. In an effort to bring to light the quality of our current operation, I discussed with our solicitor whether or not we can make public the outcome, including the full-blown decision and, you know, the reasoning and the facts in binding arbitrations, which we have, and I'm sorry, the arbitrations we go to.
For grievances.
For grievances. Thank you. And I was basically given a general answer that it would be unwise to release all the specifics. Although we have a right to know law in Pennsylvania, that may conflict with the various rules regarding privacy under arbitration law. I'm not an expert in these things. I'm not sure that this is even a matter that has been fully resolved in the courts as far as which law trumps the other. For my part, I'd love to release the results of these arbitrations. I think, Madam Solicitor, we haven't lost one yet this year, have we?
No, we have not.
How many have we had?
I think six.
Approximately six.
We haven't lost one in like 5 years.
We haven't lost one in 5 years with the prison?
With all our unions.
All our unions. Oh, boy. It makes you one think they might be somewhat frivolous if we have a perfect record. Oh, my. Well, anyway, I won't give you the names, and I won't give you all the facts, but one of the arbitrations involved an individual who was habitually late and was given multiple opportunities to correct his behavior, but he just couldn't pull it off and finally was fired from being habitually late, something in the private sector would never be tolerated. Of course, it was grieved, and we had to spend probably tens of thousands of dollars to go through the process of reviewing and arbitrating to the point where the obvious occurred. We won, and the individual remains dismissed. Another example of the superior treatment that prisoners receive at our prison involved a correctional officer who became very frustrated with an individual who approached him and demanded that he get his medication prior to lunchtime. I think it was about 11:45, and I can understand how frustrating it is with, you know, prisoners demanding things that they are not entitled to. But this correctional officer took it upon himself to leap over the table and pummel the person demanding his medication pretty severely. It went to arbitration, and to the surprise of...
It went to arbitration because the union defended this guy.
They defended the correctional officer. Thank you, Commissioner. And what the defense counsel didn't realize was that, or counsel for the union, was that we had it all on film, and it was rather graphic. If the Reading Eagle would like to seek more detail involving these matters, I invite them to file a right to know request, and maybe we can find out at some point through the legal system which law trumps the other. But I've endeavored, probably at my own peril here, to provide a little bit of detail as to what goes on with regard to these expensive arbitrations and our perfect record thereon. And that also dovetails with the taxpayers' inquiry as to why the cost of county government is what it is. Thank you for your time. All I have.
I'm glad you brought up the budget and the communications. I've received that same email and a number of other communications and conversations. And just two quick things that stood out for me. One, there is a disconnect in understanding how county government is funded and how state and federal government are funded. Largely, state and federal government are funded on income tax fees, taxes tied to some type of income, capital gains, estate tax at the federal level, and then you have sales tax at the state level. Those revenues pretty much follow with the economy. So if the economy's down, those revenues are down. If the economy's up, those revenues are up and mirror the economy. We rely on property tax, and we've raised this issue before. When costs are forced down from the feds or the state government to county, they force it from a sales and income stream down to property tax. But property tax does not follow the economy. When our citizens were being hammered by the Great Recession and saw their incomes plummet, I'm not going to throw percentages out there, but Mary and I were in a presentation where we saw a chart that compared property tax revenues to incomes and spending in our county, and it was graphic. I mean, you see the spending and the incomes drop dramatically, and the property tax never dropped. It just increased it's almost flat. But it never went negative. And if you look at the last 5 years, the property tax revenue increases well below, and Bob would know this closer than I would, inflation over 5 years has been about 7.4%. And the rate of increase in revenue from property tax has been
half a percent a year on average.
I would say over that same period of time.
2.5, 3?
Cumulative 5 years, about 2%.
Yeah. So that's pretty incredible. When you look at the proposed 4.08% tax increase, less than 2% of that is driven by decisions that this board made. I would tell you that's pretty incredible. Not only did if we had acted in the context of just our decisions, we would not be talking about a tax increase right now. The 2.65% of the 4.08% is driven by legislation and budget decisions, primarily by the state, to some degree the federal government. And people say you shouldn't ever raise taxes, period. I agree with that when taxes are a percentage of the economy. I agree with that at the federal level. I agree with that at the state level. They've got to figure out how to work within the confines of a budget. Sometimes I get preachy, and I apologize for that. But part of the problem is we think legislators and governors and presidents think they're conservative in their budgeting when they say we need a balanced budget. You can't spend more than you take in. And unfortunately, a lot of people fall for that and think that's conservative. If businesses ran in that fashion, they'd be bankrupt the first time there was a semi-turn south in their revenue. Because you can't spend year after year everything you bring in. If you look at what's happened in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania for the last several years, they're in big trouble because they're spending everything and then the revenue doesn't match and they're deeper in the hole year after year. What you have to do when you rely on that kind of income is do what businesses do. They look back 10 years, they establish a responsible base, and they spend that base, and they set the money aside so that when there is the crisis, the economic crisis, or maybe there's a major loss for that business, they're in a position to handle it. Counties' revenue it doesn't work that way. I mean, we try to go as long as we can, and there isn't a county in the Commonwealth that can go indefinitely without raising taxes. It is impossible if you're relying on property tax. That's the challenge that we are up against. And hopefully more people will begin to realize the difference in the way counties are funded versus the way state and federal government are funded.
I must say, of the several emails and calls we got about the proposed budget, one lady in particular said we should eliminate the park rangers and have park staff lock, open and lock the park system. So I responded to her and said the parks rangers, all 14 of them are all part-time, no benefits, and they provide safety and public relations for the park system. Mm-hmm. I certainly wouldn't want to slash the park rangers to save $85,000, $90,000, but that was one suggestion we received. Mm-hmm. No one said privatize the jail. No one said privatize the nursing home. No one said eliminate the libraries. No one said the big numbers, the million, the multi-million dollar ones. So,
well,
it's interesting that she pointed out the park rangers. I don't know if she had a run-in with a park ranger or something, but that was her recommendation, was eliminate the park rangers.
In fact, I don't know about the two of you. I had several people say, don't raise my taxes for general stuff, but you can raise it if it's for the Heim, exclusively for the Heim.
Right.
I'd say two or three, maybe four people contacted us and it said, I don't want the 4.8, but you can raise my taxes to keep the Heim. So,
well, one of the other issues that has to be raised, and it's really fundamental to the whole discussion of taxes and the cost of government in general, is It's human behaviors that drive the cost of government. People don't think about that. They think, oh, it's greedy county employees who have these awful pensions and these tremendous benefits. And in the fall of 2011, I injured my right knee in a flood and almost lost my life in that flood. But in it, I don't want to think about that. The bottom line was I was at the rehab office, and they were working on my knee, and the radio was on. And Jerry Sandusky had just been revealed to be this serial child molester. Everybody thought, wow, this is going to really hurt Penn State, and it's going to do this, and that's poor children, and all that stuff, which is natural and fair. No one was thinking that 6 years later we would wind up having to hire additional caseworkers, because the Sandusky behavior pattern prompted legislators to change the definitions of who is a mandated reporter of child abuse and what in fact constitutes child abuse. And the next thing you know, the county budget was significantly impacted 6 years later. And I'm not saying it's wrong to preempt and ferret out this type of child abuse, but again, it was a human behavior, a pattern of behavior that in my view has worsened over the years, that is driving the increasing cost of county government, which deals with these terribly thorny issues, such as child abuse. And you know, the disintegration of the American family, prompted in part by our wonderful welfare system that has been an abject failure for the last 60 years since it was enacted, and of course, you know, record low church attendance and low morality and all this stuff that you hear about every day on the news, this drives the cost of government, because government makes a feeble effort at best to address all these human behavioral problems, which are best addressed at the family level, but they aren't addressed there anymore. So government keeps growing and growing, and here we are. And we talk about blaming the legislators, blaming the commissioners, blaming the township supervisors for the cost of government, but in large measure it's driven by human behavior, and until that is ameliorated and improves, nothing's really going to change. We're going to be fighting over the table scraps and arguing about who has to pay what, but the bottom line is government will continue to be expensive.
Yet he
now,
created,
I sermonized.
He created an increase in caseworkers and detectives.
Yes.
Which we fully fund the detectives. We have 8 that do nothing but child abuse investigations, 8 for Berks County. Because a couple of years ago we took over the child abuse investigations from the city of Reading. So.
Well, the next point is the front page of the paper today. Auditor General Eugene DePasquale was here yesterday, actually right in this room. He invited legislators to attend. I was very glad to see that Mark Gillen, State Representative Mark Gillen, did attend. We had our leadership team from Children and Youth Services, along with Stan from COCA and Dr. Ed from Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities. I can tell you that it was an eye-opening experience for the Auditor General and for Representative Mark Gillen. Representative Gillen exchanged cards with Crystal McElhaney from CYS because he wants his office to have direct communication with her. I think that's a very good idea. But we discussed specifically these types of issues, Sandusky specifically, proposed changes that are being looked at right now that could cost this county and counties across the Commonwealth significant dollars. There is a federal law called CAPTA, and the federal law's been changed. And so the state legislature is looking at the federal law and saying, well, we need to change our law relative to newborn babies born with addictions. Right now, under current state law, a baby that is whose family is involved in any way in CYS that's born with an addiction to an illegal substance is immediately, they go into an investigation immediately. The new legislation that's being considered by the House, and Mark Gillen's looking into this, and I happen to know Jerry Knowles is also looking into this, changes it to any drug. So even where a mother is on under doctor's orders for prescription, CYS will have to go in, indicate the mother, open an investigation. What are you saying to people when they're doing everything right and they still are going to get investigated? Neither one of them knew anything about that proposal, and yet that's legislation. It's not being discussed. It's legislation that is on the docket and ready written, has co-sponsors. That's the kind of stuff that people need to look at and ask the question, are you really thinking through this? And in the other cases, let's assume that a lot of the Sandusky laws are necessary. Then fund them. I've said this so many times. If it's important enough to mandate, it's important enough to fund. If it's not important enough to fund, then it's not important enough to mandate. Completely switching gears, this coming week, Earthrise is going to be celebrating their 25th anniversary. Earthrise is on the second floor. They have a cafeteria. It was started, I believe, by Judge Grimm.
Yes.
When you see the young people there, they're part of our juvenile probation program. This is a positive way to give them skills and training. And all of us here have seen different young men and young women go through that program and in the beginning struggle just looking at you to hand change and eventually get it down just as smooth as anybody in any retail outlet. So go down. They're going to be running specials and giveaways all during next week. So don't bring your lunch next week. Plan to go down to Earthrise. Stop in there. On Monday, and this is the last item I have, I will be going up to State College and am one of the opening speakers for the Stepping Up initiative. I know that John Wetzel, who is Secretary of the Department of Corrections, is also one of the opening speakers. But this is an important initiative. Commissioner Barnhart chairs our Stepping Up initiative, and we'll be there, and you'll be a speaker later
in the afternoon.
In that afternoon?
Yes.
Monday afternoon. But this is so important. You hear us talk about our jails. Stepping Up is a national program really promoted by the National Association of Counties that looks at mental health inmates and says, there has to be a better way, and have actively worked with counties that are in the Stepping Up program to define things that we can do without legislation now and then things that need to happen at the state and federal level to address that. And this is going to be, is it 3 days, Mary?
Monday and Tuesday.
2 days. A two-day program. And I think it's important that people know, A, we are involved in this. This is, people ask, what are you doing to save money? This is about saving money, but it's also about saving lives in a very real way. There's a human component to it, and there's clearly a financial component. And we've been doing this. If we hadn't been working on saving money, we wouldn't be looking at a 4% tax increase. We'd probably be looking at a 15 or 20% tax increase. But we have saved money, and we will continue to do that where possible. Do you want to add anything?
Other than it also is a major component of CCAP.
Yes, it's our state association.
The lack of forensic beds in the state system. So mm-hmm. more to follow on that. But we had a really lengthy discussion with the leadership of the state the other week at CCAP regarding the lack of, there's about 236 available beds between Torrance and Norristown with a waiting list of 250. So they're making efforts to expand the hospital bed space in Norristown by 50. So if you're a mathematician, that still leaves 200 people on the waiting list. So it really doesn't solve the problem. And the numbers continue to go in the opposite direction, not lower. They continue to go the other way. So, and we have counties out there that are on the waiting list for Norristown or Torrance that exceed 18 months to 3 years. The folks at York County Prison, literally, York County Jail, literally have given up on some requests because it just, you know, it goes beyond a 23-month sentence, and people are basically stuck in a jail because they can't get transferred from the jail to the treatment centers that they need to go
right.
to. It's a growing problem nationwide, and it needs to be dealt with effectively.
Very good. Any comments from our row officer, Sandy?
I just wanted to add to Mark's comments on our union negotiations and our benefits. 80% of our folks are union, and 20% are management confidential. So we are backed into a funnel where 80% of the benefits come to us and we have to deal with it. And I just wanted to add those statistics.
Thank you. Any public comment? You can give your name and where you're from.
Hi, my name is Crystal Kowalski, and I'm from Wyomissing. And I am one of the protesters who has driven in to ask, please, again, not to privatize the prison, not to privatize Berksheim. We're talking about conscious decisions and what we hold dear and what our priorities are. And I'm Catholic. We're supposed to examine our consciences, right? It's Advent, and we're supposed to be doing that. And I would ask that, you know, as a community, we examine our conscience. I know we have limited funds. Everybody has limited funds. But, you know, what are you going to spend your money on? Because what you spend your money on is what you hold dear. Okay? And there are things I've personally seen 5 or 6 law enforcement officers going to a house near me for a person who didn't show up for a DUI case. How much does that cost? How much does the server fee cost for truancy cases? Are code enforcement violations, do they get served? I don't know. I don't know if they do or not. But if they're served, that's a lot of money. I keep seeing server's fee referred to the county. I don't know your job, and the one thing I will say for all of you, everybody here, the person who prepared the budget, is you do incredible amounts of work, and you really care about what you do, but I'm asking you to examine your conscience, and please don't privatize the prison or Berksheim.
Thank you. Anyone else? Again, if you can state your name and where you're from.
Catherine Anderson from Exeter Township. I had spoke at the November 2nd meeting. I missed meeting you, but I cried through the whole thing, so you didn't miss much. I'll keep my act together today, hopefully. I spoke November 2nd, also appealing to not sell Berksheim in particular. I'm here today more as an inquiring taxpayer than as a nurse at Berksheim. I reached out to several of our state representatives to inquire about the Medicaid reimbursement as recommended at a previous meeting, and unfortunately, I've only heard back from one so far. I did, however, have an in-depth conversation with him and have since heard from several other sources that Berksheim has made millions and millions of dollars. This leads me to four specific questions that I'm hoping you can answer for me today. Please remember that I ask these questions out of ignorance and not in an accusatory manner. If, in fact, millions have been made, did those profits go into the general fund to be used to help finance other county-run programs? I feel I must be missing a piece of the puzzle because it doesn't make sense to me that a profit-making business that provides quality services to the county's elderly population would be on the chopping block. Financially alone, if its funds have helped the county as a whole, wouldn't we want to strive to keep that as a commodity? If you vote to keep Berksheim, could the monies be managed differently? Could the profits be escrowed? I also have a couple of questions about the proposed 4.08% tax increase, which includes the projected deficit of the Heim. If you vote in favor of the tax increase, can the public conclude that the Heim will then continue to be owned by the county? And lastly, if you vote for the increase, but also vote to sell the Heim, would the increase then be minus the expenditure of the Heim by the percentages listed in the report, for example, the 0.63% in 2019 and the 1.24% in 2020. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
To get a written report, and we've provided this multiple times, but we'll gladly provide it again. We're talking about the cumulative. It will show exactly where all the money went from the Heim, and it's currently making money.
Okay.
But because of the Medicaid rate, it's going the other direction, so that, and by cumulative, the chart you have starts in 2006, and it starts with a debt that it was carrying, nothing to do with the construction. It had a cumulative debt. It ran a cumulative debt, even though we made money every year we've been here, until I think 2013, that money was paying off the old cumulative debt. It went positive. It will stay positive till 2022, and if we do nothing, the cumulative debt by 2027 is $29 million plus, which is impossible to sustain. This idea that the Heim has made millions of dollars and the county squandered it is not only ludicrous, it's fiction. We have supplied day one. We've supplied the data that shows all of that, and we have to keep separate, quote-unquote, books for the Heim by law. So our CFO can get you that chart so you can have that in your hand. It'll show the annual surplus or the annual loss, and it'll show the cumulative. And it goes from 2006 in the past, projected out to 2027. So that should help. As far as the 4.08, it does nothing to save the Heim. It's not about the Heim. It doesn't even incorporate the future of the jail.
And has nothing to do with the forecast.
No, right. It is not. It's about the past.
Budget, that's what we need to balance. It takes nothing into consideration.
Well,
not raising taxes. If the board votes for it, that tax increase is not raising taxes.
Right. If you remember in my comments, I broke out the 4.08%. What is driving that? Nothing in the future is driving that. Just under 2% are based on decisions to hire more staff at the jail, four county detectives to meet the Sandusky law requirement. Oh no, that's not us. That's on their side. But it was primarily the jail is the big cost driver. And then on their side, the Sandusky laws, that's part of the 2.65, some budgetary decisions that affected funding of courts and some funding for TPVs at the jail. Every part of the 4.8 is past decisions. Has nothing to do with the future.
It's unfortunate someone made an offhand comment about us making millions of dollars and banking it, but I'm glad you come here and ask us.
I agree.
You come to the source and you ask the questions and you get answers, so I appreciate that. Periodically, myself and others meet with local representatives, one being Senator Schwenk, and we compare and we say, what can the state do for the county, what the county do for the state? And the one thing I asked her the other day was, you need to get an increase in MA rates. You need to help us. If everyone in the community wants to keep the nursing home, then the state needs to come to the table and say, yes, a percent and a half, which we were getting accustomed to and being in the black with. She told me, I think it's on December 7th, her and Senator Argo are meeting with state leadership to discuss this issue. And unfortunately, over the last 10 or 15 years, many counties have opted to get out of the nursing home business because they've been, quite honestly, forced out of it. Due to aging structures, poorly managed, or a multitude of reasons, but it's as if the federal and state government are squeezing us out of the nursing care business. So she's going to do what she can with Senator Argo, and hopefully they can see some way to increase the funding, which will help. You're welcome.
I will add one other note. I continue to believe that the nonprofit option is the most viable option on the Berksheim's future. I've had some additional conversations with interested parties, and I also had a conversation with the CEO of Grady Memorial Hospital. He called as a courtesy from my fellow commissioner in Atlanta to share how their whole process worked. And one of the keys is a board composed of community leaders. That changes the whole game of this is an outside entity that owns this facility and has no care or concern for what happens in the community. So again, Commissioner Scott is one that reached out, I think, first on this.
Thank you.
And I happened to connect with the Community Foundation, I think a week or two after you did, because Kevin said, Commissioner Scott already called me on this. And I said, well, I didn't know that. I'm calling because of this. But I had some additional conversations up at CCAP. I think that that's the most viable option right now. We're being completely transparent. We have yet to hire a consultant to say, look at all the options. Ron and Christine have been talking to a variety of companies, bringing those people in to talk to us, but we're not at that point yet. I think it's appropriate to move slowly and carefully and make sure that we are making a decision with all the information, with all the data. They're important decisions. So thank you for being here.
Yeah, the board's being proactive on this matter, which a lot of boards are not. The counties that have sold their homes probably did it almost as a matter of desperation.
By yourself.
And to follow up on Commissioner Barnhart's comment, do you have Commissioner Schwenk's phone number for her? She can call her to...
Oh, sure.
Okay.
I'll get it for her.
All right.
I thought you would give it to her, but I'll get it for her.
I don't have it, but I'm sure you do. Senator Schwenk, I should say, not Commissioner.
Anyone else? Okay, we're going to move...
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
We're adjourned, and we're moving right into the election board meeting.